to Lucy and to Brady and to Alex, to Ben, to Shay, to Tyler, and to Molly. We gather on this Pentecost day to celebrate God's Holy Spirit who is at work in you. Now, when you were, for those of you who were baptized into Christ Jesus, we gathered at the font and at that time claimed the fact that God indeed has been given to seal you with the Holy Spirit. Today we pray that that same Holy Spirit, God at work in you, may be stirred up to awaken within you a greater awareness of God's presence within you today. And so as we prayed for you and prayed over you, we quoted from Isaiah chapter 11, verse 2, these words. The Spirit of the Lord, may the Spirit of the Lord rest upon you. May the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord be with you always. This is what Pentecost is about. It's about the activity of God's Holy Spirit. So this message today is not only for you, because there's many in this room today for whom, if we asked them, if we polled them, what do these verses, what does this activity of the Spirit mean, most would say, please don't call on me. We'll look at that just a little bit today, because I believe that God calls us, that God, as you have been learning, that God is calling you into a different way of living than just the way of the world. Because God has given to you a special gift. It's given to all of us as believers in Christ. It's called God's Holy Spirit. It's a special gift. You don't have to simply walk in the flesh and use your mind and use your best judgment. You can also connect with God in true prayer. And that's what the first activity of the Spirit talks about, that the Spirit of the Lord may rest upon you. It's communing with God. It's calling upon God, asking for God's word to bear fruit in your life. The second word is wisdom, the Spirit of wisdom. And this wisdom is different than the wisdom we might think that we have. This is the wisdom that comes from God. How many of you in the room would say you have made a decision in your life that you thought was wise and it turned out to be foolish? Anybody? Look around the room. You might find your parents' hands up. It's kind of interesting. You might ask them, what was that decision? Yeah. You see, at the time, it seemed like the right thing. But God gives to us a spirit of wisdom, which is greater than ourselves, because wisdom comes from God. Say after me, Proverbs 8. Proverbs 8. I'm going to call you to that chapter. It's short, and it talks about holy wisdom. And it says that wisdom comes from God, and it has what is called a personification of wisdom. From your English class, remember what personification is? It's to take an item, right, a thing, and to give it a life, like an apple. And making that apple in personification, be able to have a voice, be able to talk, be able to do stuff. So there's a personification of wisdom, and the whole eighth chapter is about wisdom itself, godly wisdom. And it says this. I'm going to read just a little bit of it. It says, when God established the heavens, I was there, wisdom says. When God drew a circle on the face of the deep, when God made the skies above, when God established the fountains of the deep, when God assigned to the sea its limits so that the waters might not transgress God's command. And I don't know about you, but I think the Rock River has not been listening to God's command, and it's been transgressing its boundary, right? It's been overflowing. And wisdom went on to say, when God marked out the foundations of the earth, then I, wisdom, was beside God like a master worker. And I was daily in God's delight. This wisdom is ours as we call upon God. Wisdom around decisions that we're seeking to make, around choices that are ours. And so as we do so, not only do we need wisdom, but the third piece was understanding, the ability to take action, appropriate action based on the wisdom. So God, what are you thinking about this choice this morning? What are you thinking about the gift that you have given me as I begin to think about life after high school what might you have for me? What courses should I be taking in high school to prepare myself? Maybe, just maybe, God has known you before you were in your mother's womb. God has some insight about who you are, don't you think? And so if we ask God, what kind of task do you want me to be upon? We will receive it. The fourth word is counsel. God gives to us not only the Spirit for ourselves, but the Spirit for other people. And sometimes that includes having an opinion that somebody speaks for you. Have you guys ever had your mom or your dad ask your opinion on something? What's your thought on this? What should we do? And hopefully it's not just something silly like, you know, where should we go for lunch today? I mean, that's a pretty easy one. It's your favorite place. But maybe something bigger. Do you think we should we move to North Carolina? Should we sell our home and move into a new place? You know, things like that. Big things. But counsel is speaking about the fact that God wants to give a spirit to us to be a blessing to others. Yesterday, I spent a bunch of time, about 90 minutes, with a couple that were wanting to have some insight, wanted to seek some counsel. I'm not a counselor, but I was willing to listen to them. So as I was listening and asking questions, trying to gain some clarification on things, I prayed inside and I asked, God, what would you have me say to them? Now, you think God answers that prayer? Every time we pray like that, God, show me, give me some insight. I believe that God speaks to us. But I also know that I also have my own voice running in my head. And I have given people some opinions that didn't turn out so well. Maybe you have too. And if you grow older, there'll be more people who ask you about this. The counsel is about listening to God and asking, what should I say? And I believe that God speaks, but I've learned to couch it, this is for the adults in the room, with this phrase. As I share this with you, let me know if this makes sense to you or if you think that this might work for you. You know, asking their engagement. So counsel, and some might. God is giving to us the spirit of might. That means that God can use you through small ways to make a difference. Maybe it's a small act. Maybe it's a kind word. Maybe it's standing up with somebody else who's getting bullied in school and having the courage to stand against the one who's bullying, to stand alongside someone who's hurting. That's courageous. That's seeking God's might to do something that's right. Okay? You tracked it with me? That's what God's Spirit does. Finally, knowledge and fear of the Lord. Dear friends, I want to remind you that God's knowledge is greater than our own knowledge. And so as we seek to listen to the knowledge that God gives, by attending to the Spirit of God within, we don't have to walk under our own power. So when we ask for God's knowledge, we should not be surprised when God gives us some insight. Where could it come from? Where could that knowledge come? I can say to you that knowledge has not come in my ear audibly, okay? But I have had thoughts that have entered my mind repeatedly that have been a knowledge word for me to help me along the path. Not to get from here to the time when I'm 90 years old, and that's not next year, okay? But to get maybe just another inch down the road. God gives enough knowledge for the next step. And so when we ask, it could come from another person who speaks to us. It could come from a mom or a dad. It could come from the Word of God. It could come from a stranger. So don't be surprised when you ask and you're wondering about what to do to seek the knowledge of God, which is greater than you, and to receive it. And finally, when it talks about the fear of the Lord, it's talking about the fact that we remember to give God awe and praise. Huh? God is God. You're not God. Even though God lives with inside of you, God will guide you, you're still not God. So as we learn to not simply use our own power, but we call upon God in prayer, remember, God speaks. Be patient. Be attentive. Listen. And you will discover how God begins to guide and direct you. But each one of us is probably just a little bit different. God wants to work in through your life. That's why God gives save us. This amazing thing we celebrate on Pentecost Day when the Holy Spirit came. People spoke in strange tongues so that they could speak to the people gathered there in the language that they knew about the mighty acts of God who has loved us all along. God has claimed your life. God loves you, forgives you. And in that way, those kinds of words, when we allow those words and actions to flow through us, I know that's got a work in you. We live in a world, you live in a school, where not everybody is kind and loving and forgiving and speaking about others, am I right? Yeah. Sometimes in our own home, we don't necessarily behave that way. That's when we're behaving in the flesh. But God calls us to behave in a new way. And that is the way that comes to me. So I thank God for each one of you today. I'm eager to see how God is going to continue to use you. Because God has already been using you. And then you learn to listen and be attentive to the voice of God in your life. And this word goes to you, the rest in the room too. Because in the same way God wants to use us, wants us to change this world in which we live. One person at a time, just our own little piece. We cannot be concerned about all the big piece of the whole globe, right? But we can be concerned about the little piece that's in our family, the little piece that's in our school, the little piece in our workplace, and even in our school, not all the kids, but there's a certain amount of kids for whom you have influence. May God bless you and use you to work for what God is up to in this world now and forever.